Hello and welcome to this first talk presented live from Gori and Leth studio here in Copenhagen. We're very excited to have so many people on board for this lecture and we can't wait to get started. The daylight talks intend to explore the significance of natural light in architecture, and we will present a list of exciting architects and educators this year and also in the years to come. These talks are arranged in close collaboration and dialogue with the International Union of Architects and the European Association for Architectural Education. And naturally, this talk is made in collaboration with the Royal Danish Academy for Architecture, Design and Architecture, Design and Conservation. For the future and for this year, we are planning 8 talks. So please stay tuned on our new website, daylightandarchitecture.com, where all the talks will be displayed after the presentations. So if you don't succeed to get on this on time, you'll be able to see it online afterwards on the site. Today we can also announce the next talk that will be on the 18th of March, with Bonsam Prentada, presented with École Spatiale d'Architecture in Paris and presented by Professor Jana Revidin. But now I would like to introduce Louise Grøndahl, Assistant Professor, Architect and PhD from the Royal Danish Academy for Architecture. Please, Louise.
Thank you very much, Pierre, and also a large thank to the whole Velus Group for this generous invitation. On behalf of the Royal Danish Academy Architecture, Design, Conservation, we are very glad to host this first daylight talk with Carsten Gori and Uffe Leth. My name is Louise Grønlund, and I am Assistant Professor specialized in daylight and architecture. Here at the Academy, we orient ourselves towards the outside world and aim to take great social responsibility. We strive to be an active, creating and leading player in relation to the major national and global agendas that are shaping our time. The Academy is a research and educational institution that is and has always been in continuous transformation. But one thing is certain, we draw on a historical foundation of practice, art and science. At the Academy, we unite 3 fields of knowledge: academic research, artistic research, and professional practice as 3 different ways to discover, invent, and create change. And when it comes to our way of working with daylight and architecture, it is also centered around these 3 ways: the artistic, the academic, and the practitioner's approach. In our tradition of research and teaching in daylight, we are occupied with daylight both from a perceptual as well as a measurable way, balancing the aesthetic, artistic way of working with daylight with the quantitative. Now in the format of this first daylight talk with the Danish studio Leth and Gori. Leth and Gori is a Danish architectural studio founded in 2007 by architects Uffe Leth and Carsten Gori. The studio specializes in site-specific construction projects of high architectural caliber and works with adaptations, alterations, conversions, modifications and transformations in projects ranging from new building to cultural heritage. And beside the studio, Uffe Leth and Carsten Gori also teach here at the Royal Danish Academy. So now, please, the word is yours, Carsten and Uffe.
Thank you, Louise, for your introduction and for the generous invitation to do today's daylight talk. My name is Uffe Leth. Next to me is Carsten Gori, and we are very happy to invite you inside our studio here in Copenhagen and to share with you some thoughts about daylight as a constructive spatial force in architecture. In today's talk, we will discuss different aspects of working with daylight in architecture through a series of projects, some of projects of others and some projects that are our own projects. Hopefully this can serve as a source of inspiration for working with and discussing daylight in architecture. As Louise explained, you're welcome to ask questions, and after the talk there'll be a Q&A session. We'll try and answer as many questions as we can. In general, the approach to daylight that we will discuss today is to work with light as something physical. To put it in a very simple way, light is invisible without space or physical matter, and vice versa. It's only in the meeting between light and space that light becomes visible, becomes physical. This physicality, or thingness, as James Turrell calls it, is something that opens for a myriad of possibilities in architecture, some of whom we will discuss today. To work with light as something physical is also an integrated part of the process of creating architecture. In this process, we measure light with our bodies, with our senses. We work with light with our hands through the process of drawing. As you can see, we are also surrounded by models here in the studio. Physical models are an important part of the process of working with daylight in architecture. And the physical models provide a wide range of opportunities to investigate the relation between light, building, space, and material. So we will start our presentation by going through a series of models to look at the relation between model and light. In the physical model, you can investigate how the diffused light inhabits and almost dissolves a structure, how it penetrates deep into the building and creates spaces of light and spaces of shadows. You can take your model out into the sunshine and investigate how the direct light enhances detail and contrast and adds a richness of complexity. And you can study the shape and depth of your project. You can also study your project in a serial progression from build model to building site to build project.
And I'll continue from here presenting a number of projects that each in their own individual way deals with daylight as a constructive spatial force. First project that you see on the screen is the old Soane Bank of London in England on Threadneedle Street by Sir John Soane. Starting from in the late 17th century, Soane would work on the bank for the next 45 years. What you see is the plan of the bank as a walled city, a city of squares, alleys, paths and courtyards. But what is maybe not revealed in the plan to us is what is open space and what is covered space, if a space is a bank hall or a walled garden, maybe, where the light comes in. This way, you could say that the plan almost could be seen as an archaeological plan, excavating the spaces, rooms, courtyards, and so on of the bank. A plan of a ruin, even. And this is a ruin. Bank of England remained operational until the 1920s, when it was then demolished. And so what used to be closed spaces are now again brought into the open in a reverse construction process. The demolition work allows for light to flow back into the deepest corners of the building, The complex is turned inside out and the interior facades become exterior walls. We are in the office very much inspired by this power, the power of the construction site, unfinished structures, raw materials, open, ended, unfinished spaces. But equally inspired by the unexpected spatial qualities that surfaced during the demolishing work. It could be compared, for example, to the work that you do in a dark chamber, this balancing of light exposure, producing photos and development time between construction and demolition, to add and to subtract. From London, we go to Paris. This is a project by Gordon Matta-Clark, Conical Intersect from 1975. This is Gordon cutting and splitting, working the chainsaw to allow for the light to enter into the rooms and the interior of the dwellings, the dwelling's most secret private spaces. So what you see is the inside connected again to the street, connecting the room to the street, turning the city or the building inside out. This is the city turned inside out. In the background, you see the landmark building, construction site of Pianos and Rogers Center de Pompidou. A building that completely changes the hierarchy of Paris. A building turned inside out with all the tubes and ducts, hidden installations, veins, blood vessels visible on the outside. So here in the same photo, you see the process of demolition, Matta-Clark with his chainsaw opening for light to enter, to pour into to the housing block, changing lighting conditions, and Pianos and Rogers' new building taking the scene again. This is a quote from Matta-Clark, making the right cut somewhere between the supports and collapse. And what is important here is to cut and to find the balance between supports and collapse, you could say, between adding and subtracting. An example of this is Matta-Clark's project in Day's End, in New York, on Pier 52, a relic of the 19th century industrial past of New York City. Here, cutting an opening in an abandoned industrial building, the light starts to pour in, slowly at first, but then cascading into the industrial basilica. You could say to cut is to create, and that's very important also in the architectural work, both in the physical work, but also in the drawing work. To cut is to create. This is why the architectural section is so important. Drawing a section is to reveal what is otherwise hidden, to show how light and space communicate, to draw cuts, apertures, openings in the section for light to enter. And this brings me to the first project of ours that I would like to present, the Elephant House, or Elefanthuset in Danish, an activity center in connection to the Center for Cancer and Health in the center of Copenhagen. I'll start with the words of James Turrell. He says, "I'm interested in the weight, pressures, and feeling of the light inhabiting space itself." The weight of light, the pressures of light, as if light was a geological force almost. The activity center takes place in the transformed former chapel. Thanks, Uffe. In Copenhagen, and what you see here is the original cassette ceiling. We are up higher under the ceiling, where the clerestory windows brings light now to the first or the upper floor in the activity center, and the light excavates or carves out space into the furniture wall, the new wall that hides ducts and installations and provide the furniture space for the activity center. So you could say that the light has been a co-designer in the design of the space, and the wall that is in a way not in the correct position is still possible this way by cutting and excavating into the furniture. It's an activity space for yoga and mindfulness. You see on the right the section in the chapel, historic chapel building, drawn from 1892. And the clerestory windows in a tall chapel space. This is a photo from the stair, new stair, connecting ground floor and first floor. Again, the layout of rooms in the activity center were made as effectively as possible, meaning that the wall coincided with the window, the clerestory window, creating a mistake or error. But instead of correcting the error, changing the plan, we started to carve out into the wall, allowing the daylight to carve out a space in the wall, making an imprint, pressure on the other side in the space next door, and creating a small space in the stair for the light to fill. We create new facade openings, views from the existing, from the chapel and to the cancer center, the neighboring building, cutting, excavating through the layers of bricks, creating new opening and carefully working with the detailing of the opening, the recessed brickwork, and how to mount the window on the outside, revealing that this is another time. This is something that has been added to the historic building, creating a new connection between the cancer center that you see in the back, Nord Architects building in Copenhagen, and the activity center. This is the former chapel, now activity center, seen from the street. The existing sliding gates are kept. We added new glass doors to the exterior to allow daylight to flow in. A tectonic study in model. You have to imagine a new floor on the top, and an activity space on the ground floor. This is what you see here. So the structure this way is a reversible structure. It's possible to demolish again, maybe in the future, in 100 years, demolish the reversible wooden timber structure, and again opening up for the tall chapel space. Trying to use the same materials, allowing raw materials, authentic materials to, in a very small vocabulary, the timber, the blue tiles, that has a dialogue with the existing historic space, green doors, red heating. And new glass door on the right side, bringing daylight into this workshop space, which is part of the men's shed that is also part of the activity center. And I'll continue again, taking a tour to London, this time talking about spaces for light to inhabit, or light as an inhabitor of space. This is, and I'm sure you you recognize it, most of you, Lincoln's Inn Fields in London, Sir John Soane's, the architect John Soane's own home and museum in Lincoln's Inn Fields. This is the breakfast room, deep, this is a breakfast room deep in the structure of the building complex. In the center, where you have views going in all directions, connecting to the museum that you see through the openings in the back, and to the right down into the crypt courtyard in the basement. And you see the vaulted domed space and light pouring in from hidden skylights. Skylights, yellow glass creating a Mediterranean light that fills the space. Skylights that are almost like light catchers or light vessels, containers, that in this very small scaled, compressed and fantastic interior still creates a number of transitional spaces, individual spaces, each with their own light, colored light from above. And what is maybe surprisingly is this roof landscape, all the lanterns and roof lights, skylights that bring light down into the individual spaces, creating a fantastic, in a way, modern roof facade. And something that we find very inspirational. What is also hidden in Soane's museum is this connection, huge panels that can be opened up, and behind that you'll find a drop into the basement again, a new light coming from above, blending in with the light of the picture gallery and into the crypt beyond that. And you see the layers of light, the skylights that color the spaces. In a very strange, in a way, and completely fantastic in interior. This has been part of our discussions in the office, Soane's own house and work for years. This is my own analysis drawing from the School of Architecture. I wanted to show you something that you could maybe connect to very directly, trying to understand the significance of the breakfast room in the center of Soane's house, here developed into a drawing that is actually a repolar drawing, so a drawing that has been developed with the use of light into a foil print. And on the back of that print, you have the pink prints that can be scraped off with a scalpel, and in that way showing how light enters into the courtyards and spaces. This is back from 1995. I'll take that into a couple of our own projects that deals with double sections or houses that somehow holds a secret. First one is our competition project in Norway. It's a pilgrimage center located close to one of the historical churches, wooden churches. This is the building, new building seen from above. You see a huge roof with apertures, openings that punctuate the roof. But what happens when we open up the roof and have a look inside it is that you see a much more organic space, a fluid space within the perimeter of the building is completely free. And again, there's a dialogue, of course, communication between the skylights and the space, but the space has also an organic power. This happens in a maybe much more low-key way in Brick House, an experimental house project we did for the Danish Foundation, Royal Danish. And you see here a double section between the huge hipped roof that covers the dwelling from rain and weather, strong winds, and then another section that is defined by the ceiling, that is much more, that becomes low and defines, brings a homeliness, sort of contains the everyday life of the small house. This is, of course, Asplund's Skogskapellet in Stockholm, drawing from 1919, where you also see this double section, hipped roof, and a domed chapel space. The hipped roof covers a large, gives a large overhang, an entrance to the chapel. The roof of Brick House, covering a new space, a veranda that runs 360 degrees around the house. A clay model built by Ceramica. And what's under the roof is this. It's an empty space that gives an opportunity to step beyond the normal programming of homes, from kitchens to bedrooms, bathrooms, and so on. And we have worked with the new owners of the building to create spaces, attics, rooms beneath the roof, and allow those rooms to have new openings and apertures, bringing skylight and views to the stars. I just wanted to show you this interest in the overhang, the roof overhang, that creates deep shadows, creates a protected space, a transitional space between inside and outside. It's something that is coming back into quite a few of our projects, but also something that we find in some of the most fantastic references when we look into architecture history, like Shin O'Hara or Sullivan in Chicago. This is a daylight plane drawing of Brick House. It's a through light. You see the openings of the house penetrated towards north and south, east and west, allowing daylight to enter deep into the living rooms. From the construction side, the clay blocks that are left on the inside are left untreated, trying to remember the construction site also in the finished project. The power of the construction site and the raw materials. Main living room and high ceiling. You see the veranda and the roof overhang through the window to the right. And daylight connecting spaces traversing spaces in diagonals through the plane of the building. A small project that I'll just quickly show you, Matiaki's house, a small detached house for two ballet dancers and their kids in Copenhagen. Very tight planning restrictions meant that the building could be only 90 square meters. So within the 90 square meters, we tried to develop the life of this small family, neighbors being very close, which meant that we decided to bring light in from above, creating a number of sections, like in Soane's museum. Each room has its own lantern or skylight aperture, where light fills the space. I found a quote from the German architect Rudolf Schwarz that some of you might know. He's definitely worth studying, or even better, visiting on travels to Germany. His projects, churches, he says, lights that drops into spaces from above as if into an open abyss. Small corridor, the green line that you see on the right is the sliding door that opens and closes the corridor to the window frame. From the construction side, and the finished buildings, almost finished building. We look forward to showing you more images of this soon, hopefully. Again, a project roof house, where in this case the whole project is the roof. Planning restrictions meant that we couldn't increase the footprint of the house on the land. So instead, new spaces and rooms were created on the roof. The existing roof is opened with new vessels, lanterns, light catchers that become skylights or even spaces on the roof. Roof is covered then in asphalt rolls, creating this strange landscape of skylights, and the possibility. What on the left you see an attic space in one of the kids' bedrooms. They can open the window and enter the roof. We say that the intensity of skylight is, as in my experience, the intensity of skylight is much stronger than the wall openings in the wall facade. So it's a balance between view and light, but the skylight is maybe something more even, especially living in the cities. We're very interested in the skylight also as a view to the sky, to see the weather, clouds passing by, stars at night. There's something quite magic about that. These are a couple of photos taken by me and my daughter visiting Dom Hans van der Laan's church in Sweden. So these are stupid iPhone photos, but they have they reveal something very surprisingly about light as a physical matter. Light pouring in the windows of the abbey into the church space. Preparing this lecture, trying to talk about the quality of the light here, it also reveals the complexity of language and and light. If I were to present this to you in Danish, I would be able to maybe more describe the subtle nuances of light, something that is very difficult when you change into another language. But I think that way it's language also reveals our sensitivity towards light and small changes in light and what it does to our body and to our perception of space. Here light becomes solid almost, like laser beams that create new spaces, or as in this image, very, very silent almost, the way that light is reflected and travels around the corner. The porosity of light is something that I'm going back now again to my own days at the Academy in Copenhagen. A number of models that studies the porosity of light. This is a model for a chamber music hall where space is turned inside out. In the center of the building is an open courtyard space, and this courtyard space is connected to the outside via windows, penetrating both the interior facade walls and the exterior walls, creating a porosity that's developed into this model, a study of the clerestory lighting. And into a diploma project from 99, courthouse, number of sections that opens transitional spaces where light works as a medium from one section to the next, creating a forecourt where you enter and the main court. This is a model of that project. A model that has been forgotten for the last 20 years, but then refound and brought back into the light again for a project called Jävla Kritiker, a joint project based on a reversed, it's based on an idea to reverse the architecture critic and the project. So the architect, the critic comes first, and the project is then drawn upon that critic. And this is, we were given the Swedish architect and architecture historian Rasmus Wern, who's among, who's working with Vingårds in Stockholm, Sweden, and doing many other things. We were given his written critique of a non-existing project, a school that Rasmus describes as a double gymnasium, where a relict industrial building is integrated and transformed into a new school complex. So the idea emerged not from me, but from Uffe to revisit and build, use an old abandoned project, the courthouse project from 99, and start and using that as a starting point in order to transform and add in relation to the critic of Rasmus Wern. So the text, SMS text correspondence goes like this from 5th of June last year. Uffe says, "An idea you might hate. It's for Jävla Kritiker, built on top of your diploma work." Me responding or laughing, "Uffe, do you think it's a bad idea? Could be quite beautiful, double gymnasium, new and old." Me, "You succeeded in making me curious, crazy but wonderful storytelling." Uffe, "We can test it and see whether it works." Yes.
The true story. We did actually
design that project on a text correspondence. It works.
And the text correspondence were followed by this sketch where the courthouse forms the foundation or basis for a new double gymnasium responding to Rasmus Wern's text. Now in it's been on display in Oslo, now going to Sweden. And we hope that some of you might have the possibility to see that, maybe even in Copenhagen someday. The final project that I'll show you is a project for the we've been working on for the last 3-4 years from the municipality of Copenhagen. It's a transformation and renovation work and new construction of 44 supportive housing apartments for citizens with mental disabilities, based on the on the countryside of Zealand, Denmark. It's an existing farmhouse complex that has been eroded during the years as a result of numerous demolitions. And in the project, we try to reinterpret the historical tight grouping of buildings, stables, cow sheds, guest houses into a new master plan that reinforces the spatial connections between existing buildings, courtyards, gardens, and new housing. So it's a transformation project where we modernize the existing 30 dwellings and have created 14 new small individual dwellings for the citizens. This is a section in the new building. And from left, you see the gable, then into one of the dwellings, a high ceiling in the main room with a skylight close to the wall to the neighboring dwelling and into the common space on the right, where the new building meets the existing. This is a daylight study in model built in the office, new block walls that where light that are washed with light. Seen from the main living room to the kitchen and the bedroom that opens up in the back. And here's some of the photos from photographer Laura Stamer from the newly finished project. You see the skylight in the tall space washing the end wall that is left untreated. So the concrete blocks with all the errors and mistakes have a dialogue with daylight, shifting daylight. And even in Denmark, we have 300 days without sunlight. And this is one of them, but still there's a I think quite fantastic play between the skylight and the daylight coming in from the wall, facade wall. From the bedroom and the diagonal lights that sort of in the reflections managed to get all the way from one facade to the other. This is from the training kitchen and common space. High ceiling. Laura is standing with her back to the existing building, looking into the new. And this is in the other direction. You see how new and old meet, the concrete constructions close to the to the former exterior facade. New opening aperture in the in the stone wall of the existing building. Model studies of facades, roof, overhang, windows, the quiet gable facades with a large concrete lintel and two recesses in the brickwork, coming all the way from within and from the existing gable that we add the new building to. And here you see it in context. Under a grey Danish sky. Beautiful light.
To finish our talk today, we are back in the studio in Absalonsgade, Copenhagen. The storefront space, which was originally a bakery, functions as our combined studio and exhibition space. Since 2011, when we moved here, we have hosted a series of exhibitions by fellow architects, for example, Rajo Framstad, Anne Holtrop, Flores and Prats, and Petra Gibb. And last year we completed an open call to design a site-specific exhibition in the space. The result that you see here is called Polychromatic Space by architects Eva Storgård and Marianne Michaels. And we really hope that we will be able to invite all of you to the opening of this exhibition later this year. An exhibition that will completely transform this space and a celebration of color and light. So yeah, thank you. So it's a very specific question to that project, but we can maybe say in general that that when we work with projects, we don't have like a set specific process. We try and attack projects from many different angles. In the lecture today, we've been focusing on daylight, but we could have held a talk which would only be about the process, or which would be about function, which would be about construction. There are many different angles, and we try to in our process to involve all these different aspects of a project at the same time. But of course, you can say that the physical work, as we described earlier, working with the drawings, working with the physical models, and working with materials is an important part of this process. In the specific project, the Stubbegård project, the openings or skylights actually changed in the process. If you notice some of our model photos, they were originally round and centered on the roof, and in the process, among other things, because of the budget, they were changed and simplified, but also moved so that they would the wash would light the light would wash down the walls of the housing, the apartments, as you saw in the photo. But it's a with all projects, it's like a process with many steps and many iterations and with many different media and angles. So there's no big secret that we can reveal today. It's about attacking it from many angles and sketching and working until you're satisfied in a way.
But we can maybe not reveal a secret, but I still would like to say that that the section drawing is a revealing drawing. As you saw maybe in the case of Soane, the section reveals what is hidden. The section reveals the connection between inside and outside, interior and exterior. So drawing and sketching on top of the section and doing that again and again could be, I think, quite good advice in order to actually understand the daylight. It's not as such, of course, a very direct, experienced daylight study. But I'm sure that, I mean, we are all of us so strong in our based on our own history, we see daylight when we see the section, I think. We see it also in the way that we, in the plan, when we work with the plan, the need for more openings in the plan, the need to close some of the openings and allowing the plan to be alive or responding in a way in the design process. Of course, to allow for views, to allow for connections and so on. But also when drawing the plan, I'm quite sure that many of us also study light at the same time. And that goes, of course, also for the section.
So that was the secret, actually, to use the section and to use to use your own body and to use your own perception. You get quite far with that. Well, I don't think we try to balance them in any way, but as we explained before, we try to attack a project from many angles, and today our focus, because we're talking about light as a physical thing, has been on the physical tools, which are also, in a way, the tools that we use most of the time. But of course, we also use digital models. We also use 2D CAD programs. But we do it in a simultaneous process where we do everything in a way simultaneously. It's not like we start somewhere and then we know that we're going to end somewhere else. So it's a matter of attacking it again with many different tools, many different scales, thinking the detail and the materials at the same time as you're working with the project in a bigger scale maybe.
I could maybe just continue by saying that some projects are slow in a way, and I think it's important to invest in certain projects in order to investigate a specific interest, daylight, for example. And that can take, of course, years, and you will probably have to continue that study from one project to the next. But it also means, of course, that some projects are fast, or developed fast, or they stand on the shoulders of other of previous projects, and the discussions are maybe different in order to realize the project and to make this project a success in a way.
When we talk about daylight, the context is very significant. You can say that the quality of daylight exists everywhere, unless maybe you're building very far underground. And it's a democratic force, it's a quality that you can find in all projects. You know, it's not a luxury, or it's everyone's luxury. But of course, there's the specific location where you're built and the light in that specific location plays an important role. I mean, we are Danes and we've grown up in the north, and we're used to this kind of changing of the light, which is very connected with the seasons, where it's very dark in the winter and we have an abundance of light in the summer. And I guess that shapes in a way also our appreciation towards daylight and towards the fact that the light changes all the time during the day. But I don't know if we can say that we have a specific...
Come on, Uwe. Country. When you want to build.
It would be interesting to study this. I mean, we have done projects in other parts of the world, but not so far from Copenhagen that we can say that the light was completely different. Mm. Maybe this is for a future project. It would be very interesting to experience this. Yeah.
No space is empty. No context is empty before we start working. All contexts have a quality, and we're very interested in trying to identify the qualities, talk about them, and somehow make them part of the design process. And that could be the quality of daylight, for example. Instinctly, I would answer your question by saying that instead of trying to mediate or label the difference from summer to winter, then try to make the most out of it, sort of fall in love with the contrast from summer to winter, enjoy the darkness of winter to be able to step back in a way from the world, or for example in our homes, be more secluded or not in touch with the world in a way, and then open up our homes and the everyday life in during summer and never go to bed. I mean, to enjoy the contrast from, and the contrast that are, of course, much more challenging the more north we go.
And to celebrate, I mean, to celebrate the light, yeah. To celebrate the darkness as two fantastic things. We had the pleasure last year of staying in Jan Utzon's Canlis, and Utzon is a master of celebrating the light. And the way that Canlis is layouted with the windows and the little window in the living room where you only see the sunlight in this specific time of day, the openings in a way becoming a story about what time of day and what time of year. This celebration of the light is something fantastic. So celebrate it, yeah.
And then the question is maybe how to celebrate that in architecture and how to make that celebration physical in designing spaces. Could maybe say as one starting point is an interest in the beauty of different materials, sort of not accepting a hierarchy between materials, but finding beauty in concrete or in the asphalt covering or in the steel, in the wood, and so on, and allow that beauty to be part of. And I guess that you're talking about interiors, allowing the natural color the natural color of materials to be part of this collage of different materials and how they constitute space. So that's maybe the first principle. And then, of course, it's about organizing and finding order between the different materials. And that has just as much to do with construction, discussion on tectonics and order in how the spaces are constructed, and then balancing the colors and how the openings and so on meet the interior space, and I have to say that some of these in the collage we also have, you know, things emerge, there's coincidences in a way in how the different materials affects and colors the light that enters spaces.
And then of course the last slide we showed, this exhibition that will be in the studio here, will be very excited because we will be working here and inhabiting this colorful structure. Maybe that will mean we will learn more about the color and light and how that can bring something to a space, how you inhabit that. We look forward to that.
Yeah, I think it's a fantastic question, but also a very difficult question. It's also a question that touches upon kind of experience and some of the experiences about, it's an experience that we all have. We are all experienced in everyday life and understanding daylight.
I can maybe continue, because I think, you know, I think when you live in Scandinavia, in Copenhagen, you try to forget the fact that 300 days a year are without sun. But in a way, this is interesting in relation to the question we had earlier, you know, how do you deal with the different deal with different site-specific light conditions? As architects and having grown up in Scandinavia, we're used to this, and I guess in Britain too, to some extent, used to this situation with the diffused light every day. A lot of architectural projects only focus on the solar light and where is the sun now? And I think the diffused light and the fact that often it's overcast and you don't see the sun for a whole day is really, really important when you design your buildings. And maybe this is one of the keys to answering, you know, where would we like to design a project somewhere else in the world? Would maybe be a project where the sun is shining every day. That would be another kind of design challenge, I think, to what we're used to. In the talk today, we focused a lot on this experience of light with your body, but of course there are also rules, laws, requirements that you have to live up to when you build. Sometimes they're about getting sufficient daylight. Sometimes they're about insulating your building as much as possible. And those two rules or regulations sometimes crash. So you have to reduce the window area in order to live up to the energy requirements. And we've tried that in a couple of projects. For example, the villa with the big roof, which is behind Carsten, which was a process where we had a client who were building a villa out in the country and they wanted to maximize the view of the landscape outside. But actually, when we have to live up to the requirements, we had to enter into a process where we had to reduce the window area quite a lot, which was kind of painful in the process, but in the end actually resulted in a kind of refinement of the project where this opening becomes something special. Instead of seeing everything outside, it becomes something unique and special and a framed view of the outside. And the house improved instead of being of poorer architectural quality. So I think our experience is that sometimes the rules and regulations can feel like a kind of opposition in the project. But I mean, there are rules and regulations that are there for a reason. And it's about getting, in a way, in the design, the best out of it when you work with it.
Yeah, it's something that has that we have a growing focus on that also because we've been working on the Museum of Copenhagen for a number of years. A museum project where the artificial lighting is extremely important in the storytelling of the museum, how to guide you through the museum from exhibition to exhibition. In that project, we worked with a young Copenhagen office called For the Love of Light, and it was our experience that during that work, focusing on the artificial lighting design, the spaces of the museum came to life in a way. So it's something that's I think it's very very relevant and interesting. But at the same time, I talked earlier upon this balance between adding and subtracting or removing, and a lot of our work is really about subtracting. Even in the discussion between too much daylight, too much view towards the outside, in a way, trying to subtract that and balancing the project so that it works also in terms of energy consumption and so on. And that goes maybe also for the artificial lighting, trying to find solutions where it becomes invisible or almost invisible. Or if artificial and where artificial light exists so far that we can design it, trying to give the artificial light its own life and character and so on.
Yeah, and also differentiate in a way the daytime and nighttime situation, and just like the experience you have with the natural light, with daylight, it also creates shadows. I mean, with artificial light, it's nice to have a situation which is the same, you know, not to have this general light which covers everything, but also to embrace the shadows and embrace the darkness in a way. Yesterday I was watching a documentary about the life and career of Bob Dylan, which was interesting in relation to this question, because in his young years, something that I can much recommend, he was very much a kind of sponge where you would kind of suck everything in a way, all the kind of information, inspiration that you can get. And in the end, for him, it turned out that he could transform in a way all this information into being very much himself and having a career where he wrote all his own material and everyone else would play his songs in a way. So being a sponge and being yourself, I think, would be good advice from my behalf.
Yeah, good advice. You can, by the way, go to Luciana channel, find it on YouTube, for example, and listen to different artists giving good advice to the young. One of the advices is that I'm not able to give an advice. Find out yourself.
That's what Bob Dylan would have said as well.
I think so. First of all, I think it's just important to study and to enjoy the years of studying is really an investment in architecture and in in finding your own interest in architecture, and I think that you should pursue that as much as possible. That said, I think the history of architecture is a reservoir of fantastic experiences, and so an advice could be maybe to look at architecture history not as history, as something distant in time, but to embrace architecture when it, you know, no matter when it's from, and focus on space, interest of, in space, of in daylight and construction materials and so on, and just dive into architecture history without that distance in time.
Thank you, Carsten and Uwe. Thank you so much for sharing. It has really been a fantastic lecture. It was really joyful. A lot of good information. I know that there has been some issues about the technical qualities. The good thing is that we have been more than 1,000 participants in this meeting. And maybe also due to that, quality of some of the images has not maybe been so good at your screens. We are very dependent on these technical solutions that we are that we are linking up to. This lecture will be recorded and we'll put it on the website. So we'll make sure that all the fine little details are included in the material that we upload. And remember, we will be back on the 18th of March presenting the Bangkok-based architect Soane Plantada in collaboration with École Spatiale d'Architecture in Paris. And Plantada will speak about designing for the senses, and he'll share his projects that are very always aware of their natural surroundings. So thank you very much for joining today, and I hope to see you soon.